Now, let's turn to the attrition thresholds established by the WWC. The thresholds identify combinations of overall and differential attrition that separate what the WWC defines as high and low attrition. As mentioned before, the attrition model identifies the expected bias for each combination. The WWC uses this model to define two thresholds for attrition, a liberal threshold and a conservative threshold. This is important because RCTs with low attrition can meet WWC group design standards without reservations, but RCTs with high attrition can only meet WWC group design standards with reservations, and to do so, they must demonstrate that the intervention and comparison groups were similar at the beginning of the study. The WWC review teams select the threshold they will use, liberal or conservative, before reviewing any studies, and they document this decision in a review protocol. The team members will use the same threshold for all studies they review under the protocol and for all outcomes within each study. The graphs on this slide illustrate the difference between the liberal and conservative thresholds. The vertical axis in each graph represents differential attrition, and the horizontal axis represents overall attrition. The only difference is where the WWC draws the line between high and low attrition. Green means low attrition, and red means high attrition. The yellow dot represents a study with 15% overall attrition and a 10 percentage point differential attrition. If the WWC reviews the study under the liberal threshold, the study will have low attrition because it falls within the green area of the model. If the WWC reviews the study under the conservative threshold, the study will have high attrition because it falls within the red area of the model. Remember, the review team selects the threshold in the review protocol before reviewing any studies, and the same threshold is used for all reviews under that protocol. When does the WWC choose the liberal threshold? WWC review teams choose the liberal threshold when they believe that the types of interventions studied are unlikely to affect attrition. For example, the beginning reading topic area uses the liberal attrition threshold since, for students in early elementary grades, attrition is likely to result from things like students being absent on the day of testing or families moving between schools or districts. It's unlikely that a reading intervention will directly affect the probability that students will leave a study. For example, families are not likely to move because their child's school is using a certain reading instructional strategy. The expected bias due to attrition is lower in situations like this, so more attrition is acceptable. Conversely, review teams choose the conservative threshold when the types of interventions studied are more likely to affect attrition. Suppose we're looking at an intervention designed to improve algebra scores. High school students often can choose the classes on their schedule, including whether or not to take an algebra course. So, a student could choose to leave a class because of the intervention. In contrast to attrition that isn't directly related to an intervention, this type of attrition has the potential to lead to more bias. The review team leadership for secondary math selected the conservative threshold because they believe more of the attrition in studies of secondary math interventions may be related to the intervention. Dropout prevention is another good example. Attrition in studies of dropout prevention interventions may be linked to what the interventions are trying to affect, dropping out itself. Students who drop out may be more difficult to track or less likely to respond in data collection efforts, which means high rates of missing data may yield a skewed measure of the difference in dropout rates between the intervention and comparison groups. In this case, the review team leadership selected the more conservative threshold because the expected bias due to attrition is higher when attrition is related to the outcome of interest. The graph on this slide illustrates the two attrition thresholds simultaneously and is the figure that appears in the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook. For the liberal threshold, according to the WWC, attrition that falls within the green and yellow areas is acceptable. For the conservative threshold, only attrition that falls within the green area is acceptable. Attrition that falls within the red area is not acceptable under either scenario. The WWC has several resources available to those looking to use the attrition thresholds. The WWC Standards Brief on Attrition is a quick source for information. The WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook also includes a table with the maximum allowable differential attrition for a given level of overall attrition under each threshold. The Study Review Guide, or SRG, allows for a quick calculation of attrition rates using built-in formulas. After entering initial and follow-up sample sizes into the Study Review Guide, the SRG assesses attrition for you. Finally, to learn more about the WWC attrition model, review the WWC white paper about assessing attrition bias, available on the WWC website. You can find it on the page for the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook, along with other supplemental materials to help you understand the standards and procedures the WWC uses in its work. Circling back to the example we discussed earlier, we know that overall attrition was 13% and differential attrition was 5.7 percentage points. How do we determine whether this particular combination is considered low attrition under the conservative threshold and whether it is low attrition under the liberal threshold? Let's consult the WWC Procedures and Standards Handbook to find out. This is a portion of a table in the handbook. In the section on attrition in the handbook, a table lists overall attrition in the first column. The overall attrition from our example was 13%. You'll see that the table includes both thresholds, conservative and liberal. So given an overall attrition rate of 13%, the maximum allowable differential attrition rate is 6.1 percentage points under the conservative threshold and 10.8 percentage points under the liberal threshold. The differential attrition rate from our example was 5.7, which is lower than the 6.1 conservative maximum, so the attrition is low under both the conservative and liberal thresholds. If an overall and differential attrition combination is allowable under the conservative threshold, then we know it is also allowable under the liberal threshold, because by definition, the liberal threshold allows for more attrition than the conservative threshold. Knowledge check 3. A study randomly assigned 5,000 students to conditions evenly. There are 2,500 in each group. The study team collected outcome data from 2,000 intervention group students and 2,400 comparison group students. Using the liberal threshold, does this study have high attrition or low attrition? The correct answer is A. The study has high attrition. Let's work through this example to see why. First, we need to calculate overall and differential attrition. Overall attrition is 12% and differential attrition is 16%. Using the table in the Procedures and Standards Handbook, we find that the maximum allowable differential attrition rate for an overall attrition rate of 12% is 10.9 under the liberal threshold. Our differential attrition rate in this knowledge check of 16 percentage points exceeds that maximum. Therefore, the study has high attrition.